G'day YouTubers, and welcome to this video where we're going to take a look at the circuit breaker, and in particular we're going to take a look inside it and I'm going to demonstrate how it actually operates. I'll be using the oscilloscope so we can see how that happens under DC and AC, and I'm going to vary the load and the voltage that we put across it. Now, in the previous video where I demonstrated measuring inrush current, I kind of mentioned the key operations of a circuit breaker. Now, they are, for one, it's got a switch which obviously connects and disconnects a circuit. So that's the one function of a circuit breaker. The other is to protect you against overload. So if you have a circuit breaker that's rated for 20 amp and your circuit is now starting to exceed that, going to 21, 22, 23, 24 amp, it'll eventually break that circuit to protect the wiring and the equipment attached to that. Then the circuit breaker also has an instantaneous trip or instantaneous break, where if there's a huge high sudden energy overload, it'll break the circuit instantaneously. So those are the key three functions, but the other function is then also inside, it's got arc dissipation. And once we open it up, we'll have a look at that and understand what that's for. I just want to highlight again that general circuit breakers in your house are there to break the circuit to protect the wiring so the wiring doesn't get too hot and perhaps cause a fire, and to protect the equipment that's attached to the circuit. However, you'll see once we do the testing on the bench that you can have certain overload conditions that can last for several seconds or even several minutes depending on the amount of overload. These are not designed to protect the human being. So you take key note of what the measurements are on the oscilloscope. I'll mention up front, a human being can feel as little as 1 milliamp AC and 5 or 10 milliamp DC. It takes as little as 10 milliamp AC for you to get that sensation where you can't release. So if you are getting an electric shock and you have 10 milliamp passing through you AC, your muscles are going to clench and potentially try and clamp onto what is electrocuting you. Anything above 10 milliamp, as you start approaching 20, 30 milliamp, that is enough to cause fibrillation, to cause cardiac arrest and other injuries. So it doesn't take much at all. The voltage levels can be as anything from a 20, 30, 40 volt range, which can cause that. There are many variables, the size of your body, the amount of fat in your body, whether you're standing in water or whether you're perspiring, will change the resistance level of your skin, which could really drop those levels so that you can sustain a fatal electric shock far sooner because your resistance of your body is reduced. If you happen to actually put prongs into your body so that you're bypassing the resistance of your skin, as little as 10 microamp can cause fibrillation. So electricity, electrocution and safety are big issues. And I'll follow up this video where we have a look at devices which can save the human being. So the earth leakage switches and the like. But anyway, let's get to the bench and take a closer look at this. Before we actually open up our circuit breaker, I just wanted to bring a few breakers onto the bench. Just talk about that you do get various types of breakers and some of their specifications. It's when you start looking into this topic, you realize, for one, there are all kinds of circuit breakers. The circuit breaker that we're kind of going to focus on today is the one which has got a thermal and magnetic breaker system inside it, which we'll have a look at it. Some of them only have a magnetic breaker system, some may only have a thermal. Some circuit breakers can be used for both AC and DC. If you have a look at this circuit breaker that I've got here, you'll see it goes through, it'll talk about the maximum ratings and voltages. Over here in particular, it talks that it can work at DC, 50 Hertz, 60 Hertz. It'll talk about, for instance, the maximum value, voltage value for DC, which in this case on this one is 32 volts versus AC, which is 250 volts. And in this case, it talks about the trip amps, which is 6.75. If we have a look at another circuit breaker at some of the ratings on here, this one you'll see it says IN. That IN means the current normal. So this is the normal continuous current load that this circuit is rated for at an ambient of around 30 degrees C. So as the ambient temperature changes, and we'll see once we open up how ambient can affect this, that is the rating that you would see perhaps in the big writing on the switch for which it's rated for braking. You'll also see here it says ICU and ICS. If I remember, it's current ultimate and current service. So in this case, they're both rated for 3000 amp. The ICU is ultimate brake, so that's the maximum current it can brake, and potentially the breaker will no longer be serviceable. And then you've got the ICS, which means you can brake that current and the circuit breaker will still be functional, still be usable. So what can happen when you're braking these huge currents and you get an arc inside on the contacts, you can actually get welding. You've got so much current and energy between the contacts when it's making or breaking a contact that you actually get a welding and a damaging of the contacts. And that is potentially the issue you get once you get these high currents that it needs to make or break. And that is what that rating depicts over there. In this case, it happens to be both the same. In some cases, you'll get a different rating for ICU and a different rating for ICS. You'll get circuit breakers which, for one, have got different connectors to go into different circuit boards. These ones are often designed for DIN boards, whereas these circuit breakers I have here are designed for another type of fitting, which I have here in the home, where you have a split phase system. It's got a little connector over there, which makes contact with a conductor in the circuit board, which slips in there, and then you wire or screw in your circuit over here. And there we can see it's got the big 20 on the switch, which means its IN, or constant current rating, is rated for 20 amps. These circuit breakers over here in my hands, you'll see you get obviously individual ones, ones which are tied together, ones which can break three-phase circuits. They don't have the kind of 1 amp written on them. They've got another rating over here, B and a 1, which means a B type, 1 amp, and here's a C type for 0.5 amp. These ratings actually give you the instantaneous rating as well. So a B means anywhere from 3 to 5 times your constant current rating, and your C means a 5 to 10 times the constant current rating. That'll be the instantaneous trip. There are a lot of ratings, a lot of different types of circuits, so it's always wise to go and check for your application, understand the type of circuit breaker you need, how it's going to operate, and also look out for various ratings on them. You'll see these ones have the CE rating, which if you trust it and you know it's not a bogus CE mark, should be acceptable, particularly in Europe. Others will have things like the CSA marking on them. So those are things to be wary of, because you do get fakes which have gotten, literally, they may just have a switch inside, switching a circuit, and nothing that's going to break the circuit in case of an overload or a short circuit. Then also just note, don't judge a book by its cover. These big hefty circuit breakers that I've got here, another type, this one only breaks 3 amps. And this one over here, in fact, has only got a 1 amp continuous rating. And in fact, these are specifically for 3-phase motors. They provide you can set them for a constant amp, or not set them, they've got a rating for continuous amps. And you can go and set an instantaneous trip adjustment. So this one you can set all the way from its high of 9 amp all the way down to as little as 2.6 amp. So that can be very helpful if you're trying to run a motor and you've got that big inrush current and you've got a breaker which is breaking because of that inrush. Instead of having to change the whole breaker, you can adjust the instantaneous trip, so at least you can get the motor starting, but then it's still got the overall protection by the constant current rating. This one is another one that is similar to that. It's rated for 3 amp. You can adjust anywhere from 30 amp down to 9 amp for its instantaneous brake. I also wanted to highlight on this one, you'll actually see it says, although it's set up for 3 phases, so you've got 3 conductors that can be wired in. You've got the line, which is the supply at the top and the load at the bottom. It's also suitable for use on single phase AC, noted over here, and it says you can actually use it for DC as well. So it says use outside poles for DC. So you need to be wary that, as is noted, some can be used for DC. The DC ratings of course generally will be lower because you haven't got the current, you've got current constantly on as opposed to alternating on and off as in AC. So you've got potentially more energy and you can easily arc and weld your contacts together far sooner than you would with AC. But just be aware, not all breakers are rated for DC, so you carefully need to read the specification. Another handy feature that some breakers have, you'll see it says actually push to trip, which will check whether the tripping mechanism is working. That is worthwhile doing, particularly once we get to the earth leakage breakers. That can be critical because if earth leakage breakers aren't wired up correctly, they won't operate correctly and protect you. It's time to take a look inside. I just want to show you functionally this switch. Generally speaking, when you set a breaker, you'll feel there's quite a hard push to get it switched on, and it flicks off very easily because it is sprung. I'm showing you that because once I show you the inner workings of the one that I've opened up, it's a little difficult to demonstrate. These are designed so that if you've got a fault, so let's say your circuit is in a fault state and you've got it switched off, or it's just tripped and you've still got an existing fault, even if you try switch it on, you will not be able to hold the switch on and override the fault. There's a mechanism inside which will override that and still break the circuit. I've gone and drilled out the little rivets which are holding this together. And if we open it up, this is what we see inside. So let's have a look at all the little key components. For some of this demonstration, I'll have to hold it carefully together because the top obviously holds some of these pins to keep everything in place. But if we take a look, first of all, we've got our terminals where you would screw in your wiring. So your wiring will go into either end of the breaker switch. We then have the contactor. So if we have a look over here, this little arm over here swings across and makes contact with this plate over here. So I'll just carefully try and move it across. So there we go, there's a contactor that'll move across and make contact metal to metal on that side over there. So you'll have your piece of wiring coming in here. It's got contact over here. The electricity will flow through there, through this arm. You've got this copper wire braid, which allows electricity then to flow through the solenoid. So you've got this coil, and you've got this little plunger at the back here, which has got is spring loaded. So you'll see the little plunger I'm moving over there. That little plunger, if I push it, can you see it's pushing out the front and activating that little lever. So we'll talk about that in a moment, but that's how that works. So the electricity flows through here, through the coil, through the solenoid, and then down below underneath, you'll see there's another coil which is connected to this little strip over here. And that little strip is the bimetal strip. So there are two different pieces of metal tied together. And when you have two dissimilar pieces of metal together, when they heat, they will bend, they'll heat at different rates, and because they tie together, they will bend. And it's that little metal strip which caters for the overload. And as the circuit gets overloaded, that'll heat up and it'll start to bend. You can see if it bends, it then hits this lever again. So this is the kind of device which will trip or break the circuit in the case of an instantaneous overload or just a slow overload. The circuit continues, it goes through here, and you can see then it is connected, it is actually spot welded or joined over here to come out the wiring. So that is the route that the electricity flows through to pass through the switch. The other piece I was talking about was the arc dissipation. Now the arc dissipation, as I said, is critical because what can happen is when you're making and breaking a circuit, you can have electricity arcing over here. And when you have arcing and ionizing of the air, that can be very dangerous. It can ionize the air and cause an explosion. So it can damage the device, which you don't want. So they've got two methods in which they try to dissipate that arc when you're either making or breaking a circuit. You'll see that as a contactor breaks, this little gap is designed to increase the gap very quickly. So you've got this piece of metal which goes down here. So if you've got an arc, it's not going to continue arcing across. The arc goes down this piece of metal and that gap increases to try and break or extinguish the arc that you might have between your one contact and the other. Failing that, what it does have is this series of plates which are all isolated from each other. And I can pull this out. So you can see it's just all these plates fitted together. They're connected with something which insulates them from each other, so they're not electrically connected. And then if you have a really big arc, that arc will then flow into here and will be dissipated within these gaps and these plates. So that is all there just to prevent this potentially exploding and becoming damaged. And again, those current ratings are set so that you've got, you can see the contact point down there. If you have a lot of energy flowing through here and high current, potentially you can have these melting or actually welding together. And that's when you're going to have damage to your breaker. And that's why you have those kind of ICU and ICS ratings to understand how much current this can take before potentially the contacts are damaged. If in doubt, the best thing is to just pull it out, throw it away, and get a new breaker. Breakers these days don't cost a lot of money, depending on the type that you get, but generally speaking, these household breakers cost anything from a few dollars to maybe $10. So next, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how the mechanism works to make a circuit, to switch things on, and then to break a circuit. So you'll see you've got some interesting linkage over here, and you've got this little piece of metal on the switch. So if I carefully hold things together, you can see as I move the switch to switch things on, the contact is moving across. But right over here, there's this little lever which has got a piece of it very closely connected to the solenoid and the other piece next to the bimetal strip. And that has got a very small notch. I'll just bring you in, if you have a look, you can see that very small little lip or edge over there. So for this to kind of arm or to be able to be switched on, this lever needs to rest in that little notch to allow the rest of the actuation and for the contactor to go across and make contact so that it conducts electricity, all resting on that little notch. So any slight movement of that notch will release and allow the circuit to be broken. It doesn't necessarily mean that this switch has to go across. So there's two means that the circuit is broken. It's either you switch the switch across, releasing everything, or this lever is released, which means that you can't physically force the circuit on if there's an overload situation. So I'm gonna gingerly try and just demonstrate. As I hold that there, you can see the switch goes across, and that is when the circuit would be switched on. And if I release it, it's because I've got everything undone, it doesn't hold this little lever properly right on that lip. So let me just relax and see. Whoop, there you go. So as soon as there's any movement on this piece over here, it will release this arm. And even though the switch is in the on position, you can see that the circuit is broken. This has come back. I'll just do that one more time. There we go, I switch it on. This time I'm gonna release it with a switch. So you can see how the circuit is made. With that, I can control it with a switch, or if that arm flicks and I release everything, it breaks the circuit. And as noted, so if the solenoid happens to push against this little plate, it's going to push that and release the circuit, or if this bimetal strip heats up and pushes the top end of that little lever, it's going to release this arm, which then releases everything else. So what I'm going to do next, I'm going to try and set up a demonstration where I actually put some current through this so we can see how that middle little metal strip starts bending once you get current applied and it starts heating up. For that demonstration, what I do need to do, I'm going to remove this link, which adds a lot of spring power onto the mechanism because I won't be able to demonstrate it. But if I remove that, I can then demonstrate how this all works. You'll have to excuse the noise in the background. I've got a 1000 watt DC power supply to supply me enough current for the testing that we're going to do. Now what I've done, I've gone and removed that pin, which means that basically when the switch is switched on, it doesn't fully get the contactor to the contact point, but it does allow the mechanism to be set. So I can still demonstrate this tripping or overload mechanism. You can see it's just sitting there on that little notch. It took me an age to get it to gingerly balance there. Now what I'm going to do is start applying current and increase that, and what we want to watch is what happens to this bimetal strip. So what I'm going to do prior to starting the current coming in, I'm going to just show you what things look like with a thermal camera. So there we can get a fairly clear view, and you'll have to excuse some of the reflection, but for the most part the circuit breaker is sitting at ambient. And if we take a look,
on the thermal camera, you can actually see the bimetal strip, which is going to be our point of focus as things start heating up. So that's what we're going to take a look at once we start getting some current through there and what happens. As I start applying current, what I want you to note is the gap between this strip and that little piece of plastic there on that little lever, which is going to potentially actuate the trip device. So it's that gap over there. Have a look at when I increase the current. I'm up to about 6.4 amp. I'm now up to 10 amp, and I think if you look very carefully, you can see that the gap has slowly closed as a strip, because it's heating up, it's slowly starting to bend towards the lever. If I bring in the thermal camera, you can now see the kind of hot areas, if you just excuse the reflection, on the solenoid or the coil, and the area around that bimetal strip that's heating up because of the current passing through it. I'm now going to start taking the current beyond 10 amp, and we'll see how close these get. We'll just give it a bit of time. You'll slowly see that that gap gets smaller. And so this is what I want to highlight, that when you get a slight overload, the trip doesn't happen straight away. It takes a while for this bimetal strip to heat up before you're going to get the circuit tripping, which is why you need a solenoid to cater for those situations where you get a big overload in a short space of time, because the heating of the strip wouldn't break the circuit. So that's why you have both the functionality. So that strip is just touching that lever, so I'm going to inch the current up and we'll see it activate. There you go. So I took it up to about 15 amp. You saw push, and then it broke the circuit over. So it pushed that lever, so it would have broken the circuit. So here we go, 1, 2, 3. It's about 19.5 amp, we'll leave it at that level. So 17.9 seconds, so I'm gonna reset that. Start it straight away. There we go, 6, reset. And that was about 3 seconds. So what I want to demonstrate there is that because there's still heat in that bimetal strip, if you try and reset any quicker, the time for a trip is obviously going to reduce. But this should also highlight and show you that it can take a fair amount of time if you're only just going over that overload limit before you're going to get the bimetal strip to heat up, bend, and then break the circuit. So in some cases, if you've got a small overload, it can take minutes and minutes and minutes. So you certainly need to have your wiring the correct gauge to make sure it can cater for at least 125 to 150% of that overload. But you need to read. Often the circuit breaker data sheets will warn you and tell you about the gauge of wire that you need to be using for the rating of the circuit breaker. So we've gone and set a base time off that testing at around 13.8 volts, and I'm going to show you the power supply. At that voltage and at about 19.6 amp, the breaker tripped in about 17.19 seconds. Now we're going to double check that. I'm going to let it cool down each time, but what I'm going to do, we'll retain the same current, but we're going to change the voltage to see if that plays a role. So over here, I have this EMS power supply, which I bought off eBay. It's able to produce about 20 volt at 50 amp. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to retain the current setting, but I'm going to change the voltage. I'll drop the voltage to see if that makes a difference, if it takes longer for it to trip or not. Initially, we're going to first test our baseline just to see how accurate that was at the same settings. There we go, slightly different, 17.81, but all in the ballpark of about 17 seconds. So now what I'm going to do, I'm going to adjust the voltage down to something fairly different. I'm going to go down to right down to 8 volts. 17.64. Nine, 17.33. 17.83. So as you can see, you'll realize from these results that in this case, with the heating of that bimetal strip, it's not the power, but it's the current that you're carrying through the breaker that will dictate the time in which it takes to break. And that is going to be very different once we start looking at the instantaneous break. But just for kicks, we'll do one more. I'm going to change the current. I'm going to drop the current to about 15 amp, and we'll do it 15 amp at 13.8 volts. There you go, 52.39. So hopefully you realize then that the correlation between the current and the voltage, when you're looking at overload, it's certainly the current which is the key factor which is going to determine the time which it takes to trip the breaker. So next we'll look at instantaneous trips on the oscilloscope.